We will all be deeply saddened to learn of the passing of Winnie Ewing, an inspiring and hugely influential politician, an MSP, an MP and an MEP, and of course the first person to chair the reconvened Scottish Parliament in 1999. I know members will wish to join me in conveying our deepest sympathies to our colleagues Annabel Ewing and Fergus Ewing, and to all her family and friends. And as a mark of respect, I have asked for the flags outside to be lowered for today. The next item of business is portfolio questions. At question number one, I call Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In light of your news, I wonder if I could, on behalf of the Scottish Labour Party, offer our deepest condolences to Fergus and Annabel Ewing and all members of the family. There is no doubt that Winnie Ewing's contribution to Scotland and to this Parliament was immense, and I remember well listening to her as the very first person to speak and open this Parliament. I'll now move to my question. To ask the Scottish Government for what reason there was a delay of more than 80 days in processing 70% of adult disability payments in April 2023.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And with your permission, Presiding Officer, can I thank Jackie Bailey for her kind words. When he was the first Presiding Officer of this Parliament, she reconvened this Parliament, and much will be said about her role in the SNP and the independence movement. I still have the card she sent me when I was first elected in my office, and I looked at it before I came down the stairs today, hence I think why I'm so emotional. She was a trailblazer for women, particularly in my party, but not just for the SNP. There will be much that will be said about her role in the SNP and the independence movement, as I say, but I hope today that the whole Parliament can join with me to pay tribute to Winnie, a life well lived. Her contribution to public life in Scotland is hard for us to measure. And can I, on behalf of my party and our members, pay tribute and give our deepest condolences to Fergus, to Annabel, to Terry and their families at what is the hardest time for any family, but particularly people in public life. Presiding Officer, I can now move to the answer for Jackie Bailey. 53% of decisions on ADP were made in less than 4 months. However, we know that some people are waiting an unacceptably long time for adult disability payment. Urgent and concerted action is being taken to speed this process up, with every step of the application and decision-making process having been examined. Social Security Scotland will continue to deliver ADP in a different way to the DWP, supporting people to apply and, where required, collecting supporting information for them. Under the previous system, people had to do this themselves before applying. The agency's focus is also on getting the decision right first time, and statistics show this is working, with only 6% of people asking for a redetermination. People can also be reassured that all payments are backdated to the date of application.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Minister for that response. The average processing time for applications has in fact increased every month since the adult disability payment was launched, from 45 working days in September 2022 to 96 working days in April 2023. Now, the Scottish Government did promise a fair and more compassionate social security system in Scotland, but people in Scotland are now having to wait even longer than people in the rest of the UK, which I'm sure was not the intention. Disabled Scots need this support during a cost of living crisis. So what specifically will the Cabinet Secretary do to address these delays and deliver the working social security system we need as a matter of urgency?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said in my original answer to Jackie Bailey, there are a number of differences between what happens with the DWP system and what is now happening with Social Security Scotland. And the most obvious one is the collection of supporting information, which the agency does on behalf of the client. That's very different to what happens in the DWP. Now, that is necessarily taking more time to do. But I would reassure Jackie Bailey on this issue that every single aspect of the journey is being looked at, all the way from the application form to the information that goes along with the application form to how the decisions are made. And we are looking at every single part of that seriously. To give but some examples of that, there have been a number of ways that we have changed in the agency how calls are handled. Staff have been redeployed in a different way. There have already been changes to application forms, particularly about the issue about supporting information. And I would say this to everyone in the chamber, if there are constituency issues or lessons that can be learned, both the government and the agency stand ready to learn on what is still a new system that we are developing, and we are determined to do better than we are with processing time at the moment.
Jeremy Balfour.
Presiding officer, on behalf of the benches here, we also want to pay our respects and associate our comments that you have made about Winnie Ewan. I had the privilege of meeting her on a few occasions. She was a woman who was formidable, but was also seeking to encourage all those who wanted to get involved in public life. And our thoughts and prayers are with her family at this time. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, it's not just ADP that are experiencing unacceptable delays. The average in processing time for funeral support payment was 39 days in March of this year, meaning that many families are having to wait well over 5 weeks before we can even start to organise a funeral. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell the Chamber why these delays are happening, and will she commit to investigating ways in which this can be fixed and report back to this Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Jeremy Balfour for this important question on funeral support payment? Again, with all aspects of the work of Social Security Scotland, there is a great deal of focus on processing times, on the issue of funeral support payment. Some of the work obviously cannot be completed until the agency has all the information from a client to allow them to process a claim. But I'm more than happy if I can receive further information from Jeremy Balfour in writing to be able to look at any specific issues that there may be or specific cases with a constituent's permission to see if more can be done to again learn lessons to speed things up where at all possible.
Willie Rennie.
Can I echo others about Winnie Ewing? She was certainly a towering figure. She made quite a mark on Scottish politics, and I can understand why people are feeling so emotional about her passing. But we want to, from the Liberal Democrats, pass on our sympathies to those people who are feeling this great loss. One of my constituents has been waiting since last October. He has a degenerative spine condition and his mobility is declining. Even though this complaint was upheld, he's only been allocated the basic rate of mobility, so he has now asked for a redetermination. So the wait's even longer because of that. Now, the trouble is that expectations were incredibly high after the government promised so much about this new social security system. So in addition to the changes that the ministers outlined, how is she going to restore confidence amongst those who are applying for this system, so that they do believe that it's worth it and that they do believe they're going to get their benefits on time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Willie Rennie for that and for the discussions I've had previously with him on particular issues? Confidence in the system is a very important one. I was up in Dundee at social security offices to talk to staff and also to clients who had both applied for and received the Scottish Child Payment and Child and Adult Disability payments. They were very clear to me, as has been shown in the client surveys that the agency have produced recently, that there is a high degree of confidence still in the service that is being provided, that people are felt that they're being believed, that they're being trusted, and they're being treated with dignity, fairness and respect. And that is a very important one. We know, however, that there is much to do on the processing times, and I hope I've given some reassurance to members on that today. As I said previously, there is a small number of decisions that are going forward to a redetermination. That is a necessary part of the system, and we will endeavour, of course, within the agency to make sure that everything is being done, that that process is as smooth as possible for people too.
Question number two is not lodged. Question number three, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the UN Convention on the Rights of a Child in Corporation Scotland Bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
I will provide an update to Parliament on the UNCRC and Corporation Scotland Bill before the summer recess, which I'm confident will provide sufficient reassurance to stakeholders about progress, the reasons for the time taken to bring the bill back to Parliament, and how we propose to amend the bill, and our continued commitment to incorporation.
Alexander Burnett.
In January, the Cabinet Secretary said that our government remains absolutely committed to incorporating the UNCRC into Scots law as far as it is possible within devolved competence. However, instead of making this a priority, the SNP government has chosen to air its constitutional grievances by embarking on a costly legal battle with the UK government to defend its flawed gender recognition reform bill. Therefore, my question is, why has this government chosen to prioritise the GRR bill over the UNCRC bill, and when can the Parliament expect to see a draft of the updated UNCRC bill?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think if Mr Burnett wasn't just reading a pre-prepared second question and listened to what I said, Presiding Officer, he'll get more information on it last week. And genuinely, I know we have differences on gender recognition, but the first question was about incorporation of children's rights. And if we could just rise above a bit of a dig about gender recognition and recognise the sheer difficulty that we have as a parliament, where we are literally having to pick out supporting children's rights because of the devolutionary setup, then that does unfortunately take time. So I'm very sorry that the member feels that he would want to conflate these two issues. They are entirely separate, entirely different, and this government will report back to Parliament on the issue of UNCRC next week.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response, and I look forward to the statement next week. Is the Scottish Government confident that its decision-making, children and young people's participation, which was updated on the 20th of June, in particular the UNCRC devolved General Comment 12 on the involvement of young people, has manifested itself in its outreach work so far on the UNCRC?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I hope to be able to say slightly more if the member will forgive me on this next week. With the Parliament's permission, I will move forward with a statement on this. I think he does raise a very important point about how we continue to involve children and young people in issues. And as I say, if you forgive me, I will perhaps say more on that next week.
Question number four, Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on whether it plans to resume the super sponsor scheme for Ukrainian refugees.
Cabinet Secretary.
Since the war against Ukraine began, over 24,700 people sponsored by an individual or the Scottish Government have arrived in the UK. The decision to pause the scheme was difficult. A surge in applications combined with pressure on short-term accommodation meant it was needed to ensure we could continue to welcome those already with a visa. A review of this decision against an agreed set of criteria is underway, and Parliament will be updated in due course. In the meantime, people can apply for a visa with an individual sponsor.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government seems to have overstretched itself with its capacity and resources with the super sponsor scheme for Ukrainian refugees, leaving many in a perilous position, unsure of where they will live and when the government's short-term housing may run out for them. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what measures, if any, she has taken to ensure that every sponsored refugee taken in by the Scottish Government will be given long-term housing options as soon as the short-term housing option contracts end, given the fact that the scheme was paused in July last year due to a lack of availability of housing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for the question, but can I caution about suggesting that people are in perilous positions? These people that we are speaking about here have came under circumstances that we can't even begin to imagine coming to Scotland in. And that's why it's very important that there is a reassurance that the short-term welcome accommodation is there. Now, of course, there's a great deal of work going on around long-term accommodation with the private rented sector, with councils, and that's why there's a number of councils who have taken up the opportunity of using the Scottish Government funding to bring back voids and to bring other accommodation back into use for our Ukrainian guests. And that is something which I'll be more than happy to provide further information to the member on if she wishes.
Question number five, Ben McPherson.
To ask the Scottish Government regarding any implications for refugees from Ukraine, whether it will provide an update on the disembarkation of the MS Victoria prior to the ship's planned departure from the Port of Leith on the 11th of July.
Cabinet Secretary.
There are matching teams on board the MS Victoria supporting all guests to move on to suitable alternative accommodation before the contract ends on July the 11th. The teams work closely with guests to encourage them to consider a range of housing options, including social housing, private rented sector, properties, hosted accommodation or alternative welcome accommodation, including hotels. We remain on course to safely disembark the ship ahead of the end of the contract, with the majority of guests that were resident now having already departed or with plans to disembark in the coming weeks.
Ben McPherson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and pay tribute to all of those involved in this operation, and appreciate and welcome the work underway by matching teams on board the MS Victoria to provide assistance and minimise the inevitable disruption by helping guests successfully transition to new accommodation through a trauma-informed and person-centred approach, as the Cabinet Secretary has emphasised. I'd also be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could provide an update on ongoing discussions between the Scottish Government and the private rented sector to help remove any remaining barriers to access to suitable accommodation for my constituents, especially regarding the cost of deposits to secure tenancies.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Ben McPherson for that question and pay tribute to the work that he and Deirdre Brock MP have done to support their newest constituents while they have been in leave. In addition to providing £1.72 million in grant funding to bring 100 properties in the city back into use, we are working with COSLA and local authorities to consider whether we can bolster existing local authority support packages that help people with the cost of deposits and other barriers to accessing private rental properties. Officials and the Minister for Housing have also engaged directly with letting agents, landlords and credit reference agencies to understand and overcome some of the non-monetary barriers to accessing private rental properties and ensure displaced people from Ukraine are able to access information about private tenancies. And if Mr McPherson has further constituency work, as we have done in the past on this, I would be more than happy to work with him alongside my colleague, the Minister for Housing.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I associate myself with the words of Ben McPherson, but also take this opportunity to thank those who work in our schools in Edinburgh who have offered a very warm, supportive learning environment to these young people whilst they've been educated here in Edinburgh. My question was in relation to maintaining connections between these young people. We know that many of them will now be moving to different parts of the country, but their support network is here in Edinburgh. So I wondered what support will be provided to make sure that they can continue to keep these relationships going in the future.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I associate myself very much with the remarks that Miles Briggs has made about the warm welcome that's been given within our schools, particularly but not just in Edinburgh, to our youngest Ukrainian guests. It is very important that councils are working together on this. The City of Edinburgh Council has not been the only council that's been on board the ship. Many others have as well. And the council within Edinburgh and other councils are working exceptionally closely to make sure that we are doing everything we can within public agencies and indeed the third sector to ensure that we're doing everything possible to maintain connections and make the transition from MS Victoria to other accommodation as seamless and as easy for people.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On Monday at the CPG for Mental Health, of which I'm a co-convener, we heard a presentation from Edinburgh-based charity Fenix on the mental health and integration needs of Ukrainian refugees settling here. Its findings from those reporting to their responding to their survey suggest more support is required in terms of refugees navigating the system and accessing services such as mental health and children's services. So what additional measures can be provided to those who have sought sanctuary in Scotland to ensure that they get all the support they need, and what can be done to ensure the support is trauma-informed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, again, another very important issue, Presiding Officer, about the fact that this is not just about housing or indeed schooling, but about ensuring that we wrap around as much support as possible for Ukrainians as they come to Scotland for however long that may be. The issues around support, whether it's in the health service or indeed wider services, is something which obviously Scottish Government officials and councils and other public agencies are working very closely on. If there are particular concerns from the cross-party group, I would be more than happy to receive further feedback on that, and with myself and Emma Roddick would be very interested in the results from that to see what we can learn.
Thank you. Question number six, Michelle Thompson.
Ask the Scottish Government what support is being provided to Social Security Scotland in light of the continued transfer of cases from the Department of Work and Pensions and increase in applications.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are working closely with Social Security Scotland and the DWP to safeguard the transition of client awards to the agency. This is a joint delivery programme. We are prioritising the safe and secure transfer of client data. We are closely monitoring the number of applications for disability benefits against our forecasts and exploring a range of ways to improve our application processes, including taking a comprehensive look at every step in the journey from people applying for a disability benefit to getting paid. Good progress is being made on the transfer of awards from the DWP.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Now, I've been contacted by several constituents citing delays to their payments, with one constituent advising they've waited over 4 months for their paperwork to process and a decision to be made. Now, during this time, they were supporting an ill family member residing in the same household and had to travel to hospital appointments with very little income. To that end, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm what support the Scottish Government can provide to Social Security Scotland to ensure they continue to maintain a person-centred approach whilst implementing their first-come, first-served case management system?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I mentioned to members in previous answers, there is a great deal of work going on within Social Security Scotland and indeed the Social Security Directorate in Scottish Government to ensure that action is being taken on every step of the process to see what can be done to speed up processing times. And progress is being made. Again, I would reassure members that more decisions are being made per week now than they have been in the past. So we are seeing improvements. I go back again to the issue of the fact that the agency collates the supporting information, which is very different to what happened under the DWP, where it was the client that had that responsibility. What we are looking very carefully at, both within government and the agency, about what more can be done to speed up the process of receiving that supporting information and then the decision being made. But again, if Michelle Thompson has particular constituent cases that she would like me to look into, I would be more than happy to do so.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that the Government has spent almost £280 million on an IT system for the agency with no end in sight, and we know that there are significant challenges to people getting a response on the phone or online. Can the Cabinet Secretary say what action has been taken immediately to ensure that people can get through and get an answer on these issues?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, that IT system is the IT system that delivers the Scottish Child Payment, Presiding Officer. So there's one end that we have already well in our sights that is providing support directly to children and their families right across the country. But now that I've made that point, I will say there is an issue around telephony, and that's why the agency has and will continue to see what more can be done to improve the call waiting times. There has been improvements again in this area because of some of the steps the agency has already taken, and again I'm more than happy to share further details of that with the member in due course should he wish to see them.
Question number seven, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the levels of child poverty in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
As our progress report published last week shows, our focus on tackling child poverty is unequivocal and making a significant difference. However, there are still too many children living in poverty in Scotland. Economic modelling published last week estimates that 90,000 fewer children will live in relative and absolute poverty this year due to Scottish Government policies, with poverty levels 9 percentage points lower than they would otherwise have been. This includes lifting 50,000 children out of poverty through the Scottish Child Payment. We are, however, doing this with one hand tied behind our back, given the UK Government's decade of austerity, a hard Brexit and their mishandling of the economy, which is why we will continue to argue for the full powers to tackle poverty to be in the hands of this Parliament.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of shocking statistics, because she mentioned them just there, that showed a third of children in Glasgow are living in poverty, and the neighbouring local authority, South Lanarkshire, around a quarter of children live in poverty. I agree wholeheartedly that cruel Tory policies like the two-child cap should be scrapped, but the government could and can do more here to eradicate poverty. One way it could be doing that is through funding local authorities to enable them to continue with their summer holiday food programmes, which provide targeted support for families in need and ensure that children at least get one hot meal a day. The government have provided no clarity whatsoever on funding that will be available for local authorities to deliver on those programmes, and both Glasgow and South Lanarkshire councils are crying out for clarity. So when will the government confirm this funding? Because schools in Glasgow close for the summer tomorrow, and South Lanarkshire schools finish on Tuesday. Thousands of children look set to lose out on this crucial provision simply because of this government's indecision.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'd be happy to provide the member with further information about the refocusing of the funds in that issue. But can I gently say to him, I'm really glad he thinks some of the welfare policies should be scrapped and changed. It's just a shame UK Labour don't agree, and when there's no change that's happening at this level within the Scottish Conservatives and their masters down south, and indeed with UK Labour as well.
Let's hear
the
Cabinet Secretary.
It is deeply disappointing that once again, Presiding Officer, we have people coming here expecting the Scottish Government to have to mitigate against the worst of Tory and apparently now Labour welfare policies.
Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Analysis shows that 90,000 fewer children will live in poverty as a direct result of the actions and decisions this Scottish Government is taking with its limited powers through the Scottish Child Payment. And of course, mitigating cruel Tory policies such as the bedroom tax and the benefit cap. However, as the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned, we are acting with one hand tied behind our backs. So can the Cabinet Secretary remind the Chamber what the impact would be on child poverty levels in Scotland if key UK welfare reforms were reversed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the UK Government's welfare reforms have been hugely damaging to people in Scotland and indeed right across the UK. They are driving people into poverty, and that is a political choice that the UK Government have made. They've also meant that some Scottish Government policies are simply mitigating against the impact of UK Government cuts. Scottish Government analysis published last year showed that reversing key UK Government welfare reforms since 2015 would bring an estimated 70,000 people out of poverty in Scotland, including 30,000 children, in 2023-24. We have repeatedly asked the UK Government to reverse these cuts, which are inflicting damage upon households right across the country.
Question number 8, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plan Cash First towards ending the need for food banks in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Earlier this month, Scotland became the first nation in the UK to publish a plan to work towards ending the need for food banks. This includes a new £1.8 million programme to improve urgent access to cash in a crisis. As the Trussell Trust note, the efforts of this government to tackle poverty, including through the Scottish Child Payment, will help to raise incomes so that fewer people need to turn to emergency food parcels.
David Torrance.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Data from the Trussell Trust indicates that the Scottish Child Payment has reduced the demand for emergency food bank use. At the same time, we know aspects of the UK Government welfare system, such as sanctions and a 5-week wait for universal credit, has caused an increase in demand for food banks. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree there is a limit to what we can achieve here in Scotland while we are under Westminster control?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, David Torrance is quite right to point out the limitations that we have within our devolved powers and a fixed budget. And the Trussell Trust is right to note that the efforts of this government to tackle poverty, in particular child poverty, through the Scottish Child Payment will help to raise family incomes. It is a shame that the UK Government does not share our determination to tackle child poverty, to lift children out of poverty so that they can reach their full potential.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. I'll allow a moment for front benches to organise themselves.